لا حول ولا قوة
لا إله إلا الله
لا إله إلا الله إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمد عبد الله ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد فإن خير الحديث كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Indeed, all praises are for Allah, the Mighty and the Most High. And we mention His beautiful names and His perfect attributes. And we thank Him and show our gratitude for all that He has done for us, all that He does for us, and the things that He has promised to do for us. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla, the Mighty and the Most High, for forgiveness, for pardon, and for a second chance. As some of us, maybe a third or a fourth or fifth or sixth or a seventh chance. We've sinned and sinned and sinned. And we still get on our knees and we beg Allah for forgiveness. And He is kind and merciful to grant us that forgiveness. We ask Allah, the Mighty and the Most High, for help to support us. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to supplement our weakness and our limited vision. And oftentimes our blindness. Some of us, we have limited vision. We can see just a bit. I think about tomorrow, but not next week. I think about next week, but not next month. I think about next month, but not next year. I think about next year and the next 5 and the next 10 and maybe the next 20. But I don't think about my afterlife. I don't think about when I become old and weak and sick and I don't have the ability to say sorry. And to apologize and to send it back and go and do the right thing. So those of us who have vision, our vision at best is limited. Our vision at best is partially cloudy. Our vision at best is impaired, let alone the state of most of us in which we're just blind. We don't even have vision. We can't see. We're not even looking. Our eyes are not open. We're not trying to open them, nor can they be open if we tried. وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. And that's what we ask Allah for help. And we ask Allah for guidance. We ask Him for divine vision. We seek refuge in Allah from the evils of our souls and from the consequences of our bad deeds. Those who are guided by Allah, it's because Allah has guided them. And those who are misled, they are not Muslim, they're not pious, they're not righteous, they are not upon the sunnah of the Nabi al-Kareem. It's because Allah Azza wa Jalla chose to mislead them and not to give them guidance. I bear witness and I testify that Allah, alone without any partner, is the one who deserves to be worshipped, the only true God. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is His apostle, is His prophet, His messenger, and at the same time His servant, His slave, His worshipper, the one who devoted and dedicated His life to the pleasing of His Lord and His Master. So with that being said, may Allah Azza wa Jalla be pleased with the messenger of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And may Allah extol and make His name high and celebrate it among the high angels and among all of the people. And may Allah Azza wa Jalla be pleased with His wives, our mothers, the Ummahat al-Mu'mineen, starting with Khadija to the very last of them. And may Allah Azza wa Jalla be pleased with all of the companions, the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam's relatives, His household, His Ahlul Bayt, and the closest of the close, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, and Umar al-Faruq, and Uthman and Ali and the other companions who were given the promise of Jannah and the other Sahaba who were not included in the 10 but they also had the glad tidings of paradise, whether it was Bilal or other than Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa an sahabati ajma'in. To proceed, the best speech is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the best guidance is the guidance of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, and the worst is not the best. The worst is not the best. That which is imperfect is that which is imperfect. And that which is perfect isn't imperfect. The sunnah is the best. And that which is other than the sunnah is the worst. The way of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and worshiping Allah and serving Allah, that is the perfect way. And if it's not the way how Muhammad got close to Allah, then it is obviously imperfect. And it is bad, and there's no good that can be done in worshiping Allah if Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not legislate it. If the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't say it or do it or allow his companions to do it. Because the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, one of the following things must have taken place if he forgot or if he didn't tell us to worship Allah and serve Allah in this manner. Number one, is the Prophet knew it was a good thing. And he knew it was a means of getting close to Allah. He knew this. But he didn't want to tell us. He chose to hide it, to conceal it. He chose to betray the amanah and not give his followers what was good for them. Not to tell his sheep, his flock, his herd, the good ground of grazing and pasture. So that's the first scenario. Scenario number two, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he knew it was good. He was taught by Allah that it was good. And he wanted to tell the people, but he forgot. Maybe he slipped his mind. He was only but a man. He was liable to forget. Maybe the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he forgot to tell us about this act of ibadah. Scenario number three, he wanted to do it. He knew it was good. He did forget, but he wasn't eloquent enough to tell us how to do it. His words weren't strong enough. He wasn't fluid enough. He didn't have the proper tongue to tell us what to do and how to do it. Which Muslim in his right mind will stand in front of Allah Azza wa Jalla with these three scenarios? Which Muslim in his right mind will stand in front of Allah and will answer these three questions in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Which Muslim? No Muslim in his right mind would ever say that the Prophet betrayed us, or the Prophet forgot, or the Prophet wasn't a good messenger, he wasn't a good delivery man, he didn't deliver the package properly. No Muslim is going to say this. And this is the reality of bid'ah. This is the reality of making dhikr or salah or some type of tawbah or some type of belief that you get closer to Allah with. And Muhammad did not let us say, that's the reality. That's what you're telling Allah. And if you don't say it with your tongue, you're saying it with your actions. That your messenger wasn't enough. Your messenger wasn't sufficient. Your messenger didn't do the job 100%. And then I've come to finish what he left off. I've come to patch up. I've come to complete it and finish it. This is the reality of innovation in the deen. So when you see your family members doing it, or an innovation that you may be doing, or an innovation that you may have seen in your country, or in another masjid, or when you first became a Muslim in jail, know for sure the ugly stench of bid'ah. And it is not a small thing. It's not an issue of ijtihad. It's not an issue of, you know, qushur, lub wal qushur, a small type of thing. It's a serious issue. And what you're telling Allah through your actions is that there's something which is incomplete. Al-yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum. On this day, I have completed your religion for you. Oh Allah, you didn't complete the religion for us. There's something that's left. And my sheikh is going to figure it out. And my madhab, they came up with it. My cultural Islam, they figured out the thing that Allah forgot. That's what you're telling Allah. So it's very dangerous to commit innovations. And it's very dangerous to practice innovations and to make innovations. And it is not a small, simple thing. And that is why the Prophet ﷺ warned his companions against bid'ah before they even made it. He warned them against innovation before there was any innovation. He said this every single Friday in his khutbah, his sermon, because he knew of the dangers that lie ahead for the ummah. To proceed. قال الإمام البخاري رحمه الله تعالى في كتابه الجامع الصحيح حدثنا عبد الله بن يوسف قال أخبرنا مالك عن أبي الزناد عن الأعرج عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إياكم والظن فإن الظن أكذب الحديث ولا تحسسوا ولا تجسسوا ولا تناجشوا ولا تحاسدوا ولا تباغضوا ولا تدابروا وكونوا عباد الله إخوانا أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام والحديث أخرجه الإمام مسلم. It is a well-known reality and a clearly established fact that when the Muslims migrated, when they left Mecca and they went to Medina, their lives changed dramatically and drastically. Their lives were different. Their lives were no longer the same. From a spiritual aspect, from an economic aspect, from a political aspect, from a social aspect. Things were different when they got to this place that they used to call Yathrib. Everything was different. The location was different, the culture was different, the climate was different, and how they lived as Muslims was different. They were no longer a small, tiny, weak, inferior force. They weren't a people that were hiding and afraid and scared and terrified. They weren't a people that was paralyzed and crippled by lack of economic structure and financial structure. It was no longer every person for himself and hide and do what you can. But there was now a need and a necessity to establish family life, community life, life of society, life of a city, and life of an Islamic state. This was the atmosphere and the environment in Medina. In Mecca, they were being persecuted. Some of them were tortured. Some of them were murdered. Some of them were harassed. Some of them were harried. They did things to the Muslims. The Muslims weren't all together, all unified openly, publicly, and outwardly. But when they got to Medina, those things changed dramatically and drastically. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from His wisdom and from His mercy, He knew that the Muslims now needed new instructions. And the Muslims needed new guidance. And the Muslims needed the steps and the keys and the ingredients of establishing, maintaining, and continuing to flourish this community and this society. And from those instructions and from that teaching is what Allah Azza wa Jalla mentions in the Quran and the chapter which is called Suratul Hujurat. The chapter of the Hujurat, the houses, the apartments, the rooms, the chambers in which the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam lived, his wives lived, and there were other Muslims, other companions who had houses and places in which they lived. And Allah Azza wa Jalla, He gave instruction to the Muslims. Things that He knew they needed to live, not how they lived in Mecca, but now how they live in Medina. And that's because they are a body now. They are together now. So Allah Azza wa Jal, He laid down the foundations of brotherhood and sisterhood. And He laid down the foundation of a household, of a community, and of a state. How to live together as one. Allah Azza wa Jal, He mentioned the key fabric to the tunic of brotherhood. And He mentioned the integral threads to the frock of sisterhood. How to live and love each other and grow and flourish together. And that is what Allah Azza wa Jalla says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, Ijtanibu kathira min al-dhan, Inna ba'd al-dhan ithm, Wa la tajassasu. Allah says, O you who believe, O Muslims, it's no longer Ya ayyuha al-nas, Ya ahl al-kitab, O Muslims, only Muslims, اجتنبوا كثيرا من الظن, avoid doubts and avoid suspicion and avoid thinking and looking and using your mind too much for your brother. إِنَّ بَعْضَ الظَّنِّ إِثْمٌ فَإِنَّ بَعْضَ الظَّنِّ إِثْمٌ. Because much of you thinking and you having suspicions about your brother is sin. It's a means of sin. It's sin itself and or it leads to sin. Having suspicions about your brother may not necessarily be a sin, but it will definitely lead to a sin. It will cause you to fall into a sin. And once you start thinking about your brother and having suspicions about your brother and having pre-assumptions about your brother, Allah says, وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا, and do not spy upon each other. And that's because spying is nothing more than the child of suspicion. Suspicion is the father of spying. Because I only spy on you and look through your personal paraphernalia and your things because I think something about you. And now I need to prove it. I have suspicions about you. Now I need to solidify them and make them concrete. I.e., I believe before I investigate and search. I come up with a theory before I've gathered the necessary data or data. And that's wrong in Islam and in the world among the non-Muslims as well. So thinking bad about your brother, having suspicions about your brother, leads you to spying on your brother. And what happens when you spy on your brother? What does it do to yourself, your own heart, your own mind, your own soul? When you spy on your wife, what does your marriage become? When you accuse your husband of unwarranted things, what does your marriage become? When the leaders accuse the subjects of being disloyal and cowardly, and when the subjects accuse the leader of being a thief and embezzling their wealth and him being cowardly and him being oppressive, what happens to the state? What happens to the Muslim country when the people have dhan and when the people have tajassus, when they have suspicions and then they spy upon each other? They think a certain way about their brothers and sisters, even if it's someone who sleeps next to you. Someone who's your own flesh and blood. Someone whom you feed, someone who feeds you. But that still doesn't stop you from, maybe that's not the case. And maybe he's hiding something. And maybe, and perhaps, and I don't know. Now I need to prove it. I need to verify it. Legally or illegally. With Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all success. Alhamdulillahi wa kafa. Wa salatu Allahi wa salamuhu ala ibadihi alladhina astafa amma ba'd. قال ابن جرير الطبري رحمه الله تعالى في تفسير هذه الآية أي ولا يتتبع بعضكم عورة بعض ولا يبحث عن سرائره يبتغي بذلك الظهور على عيوبه ولكن اقنعوا بما ظهر لكم من أمره وبه فاحمدوه أضموه لا على ما لا تعلمونه من سرائره. ابن جرير رحمه الله he said regarding this verse in the Quran, this means do not look for the mistakes of others. Do not search for the faults and the flaws, the awra, the nakedness of others, the private parts of others. Don't look for the nakedness of others. However, you should be pleased with the clothes that they are wearing. Be pleased with that which is outward and plain. Do not search for people's secrets, looking for someone's mistakes and errors, looking for someone's flaws and someone's shortcomings. However, he says, اقنعوا. He says, be content and be pleased with that which is apparent. And based off of what you see, and based off of that which is outward in the open, فَحْمَدُوهُ. Praise the person, أَوْظُمُّهُ. Or dispraise them. This person is righteous, inshallah, because of what we see. And this person doesn't seem so righteous. What does he do when he goes home? When he goes home at night, does he pray? Maybe. He may pray at night, all night, more than me. I'm sleeping and he's praying. But outwardly, he's not upon righteousness. And that is what we say. And do not search for a person's secrets and then judge them based off of that. Do not judge someone based off of that which you do not know. But judge them based off of what is plain and that which is apparent. Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, he's narrated with his chain, his isnad, that goes back to Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, that the Prophet said, إِيَّاكُمْ وَالظَّنِّ. He says, beware of dhan. Beware of baseless thoughts. Beware of unwarranted suspicions of your brother. Beware of accusations which are not based off of anything. Why, O Messenger of Allah? Why can't we have suspicion? Why can't we look and search and think? Why not? Are we to be naive and foolish and just be cheated by the people? The Prophet ﷺ says, فَإِنَّ الظَّنَّ أَكْذَبُ الْحَدِيثِ. And that's because dhan, baseless suspicion, is the most false discourse. It's the falsest discourse. It's no facts. It's nothing that's truthful when you just think and conjure something in your mind. And then the Prophet ﷺ, he says, وَلَا تَحَسَّسُوا. He says, and do not make التَحَسُّس. And the scholars of Islam, they say that this word, التَحَسُّس and تَجَسُّس, بِمَعْنَى واحد. Mutaradifan is synonymous. And others, they say, no, there's a difference. A tajassus, spying on someone, and a tahassus, seeking to feel someone, is a bit different. And there's a subtlety between the two. At the end of the day, the Prophet ﷺ, he says, وَلَا تَحَسَّسُوا. Don't be oversensitive. وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا. And do not spy. Don't be a spy. Do not look into people's personal affairs. And then the Prophet ﷺ, he says, after that, giving us more instruction of how to be brothers and how to be sisters and how to live as one body and as one community, he informs us, he says, وَلَا تَنَاجَشُوا. And do not try to cheat your brother when it's time to buy and sell. Like we have an auction and a person is making a bid and he claims that this is the price, 400. Can I get one for 400, 400 for 20, 450? And a person is raising 450. And then another person says, 475. And he says, I'll take it for 500. And the price keeps going up and up and up and up. But the one who's making the bid, or the one who's auctioning, and this person, they're in cahoots with each other. And he's doing nothing but raising the price and hiking up the price to break the backs of the people who actually want the product. The Prophet says, do not do that. And this applies to any other type of cheating or underhand dealings with money, which many Muslims suffer from. I hire you, I don't pay you. I pay you, but I pay you short. I give you a product and it's flawed, it's faulty. Why do the Muslims have the worst customer service? Why do the Muslims have the worst and least and the most foul quality of products? Because the Muslims are not pondering on the words of the Prophet ﷺ. He tells us after that, he says, وَلَا تَحَسَدُوا. He says, and do not have envy for each other. Do not be jealous against each other. If your brother has something that you don't, be happy. Alhamdulillah, Allah bless you with it. May Allah make you happy with it. May Allah give you better. Allah give me something similar. If that's good for me, be happy with what your brother has. La tahasadu. Don't be envious. The Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, La tabaghadu. He says, don't hate each other. Don't show enmity towards each other. Let the grudge go. Let the beef go. Let it go. Forgive, forget. You don't have to be naive. You don't have to be stupid. You don't have to be foolish, but let it go. Don't hold on to the grudge. The Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, he didn't tell us after that. He says, وَلَا تَدَابَرُوا. And do not plot against each other. Do not scheme against each other. As if these words have fallen upon deaf ears. People who have knowledge and ilm, or some type of knowledge and ilm, they scheme, and they plot, and they cheat, they hate, and they're envious creatures. And they acclaim ilm, and they claim to follow the Salaf al-Salih. And every refutation is a scheme and a plot. And it's based off of envy, and it's based off of looking for someone's mistakes and errors. Searching and digging and fishing, and then bringing it to the surface. Last but not least, the Messenger of Allah, alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, وَكُونُوا عِبَادَ اللَّهِ إِخْوَانًا. He says, the most comprehensive thing is to be brothers for Allah. Be ibadullah, servants of Allah, and be brothers. That is the thing which joins me with you. You're from India, I'm from Philadelphia, but we're both Muslim. You're from Brooklyn, I'm from Queens. You're from Guyana, I'm from Trinidad. I'm from this country and that country, but we're all Muslims. And before that, we are all slaves of Allah. All of us have the same DNA, which is sticky clay, clean and lazib, which is turab, which is dirt. This is the DNA that we all share. And from one aspect or another, we're all on a similar level. And that is that we are servants of Allah, so let's act like that. And we are to be brothers with each other, so let's act like that. So if you were to ask me, what are some of the harms of spying? Or what are some of the examples of spying? Or some of the manifestations of spying? Spying is a very broad topic. Sometimes you can spy on someone with their phone, with their computer, with their tablet, with their house, with their car. And many brothers, they do this. They give you the salams, salamu alaikum. And he's looking at something else as he shakes your hand. Or he plays with your phone, he looks through your stuff. Or he makes a joke about your personal business, where you are on this day or that day. A person, they look for you, they track you down, and they spy on you. And then when you find something which doesn't please you, which upsets you, then they become upset. And it's from the wisdom of not spying on each other. It's because it breaks down the fabric of society. What happens when you spy on the leader? And you find that the leader isn't so pious. He isn't so righteous. He's flawed, like you're flawed as a human being. But he tries to hide it. But now you've felt his mistakes and his errors, and now you can't take anything from him anymore. It breaks down leadership, and it breaks down role models. This is from the greatest harms of spying on someone. Because someone could be a good leader outwardly, and they're pious and they're righteous, but they have mistakes that they're trying to hide and they're trying to fix. But by you spying and meddling, you've now destroyed leadership and leaders. And what happens when a community has no leadership? What happens when a country has no leader? We all know what happens. There's chaos, there's mayhem, and there is havoc. And most importantly, the greatest harm of spying on each other is that it's disobedience to Allah and His Messenger. It is disobedience to Allah and His Rasul, which is the cause behind every act of misery upon this earth. As it states in certain narrations, that the land, the earth talks. The trees, the stones, the rocks, the things, the animals, they talk and they say, La'natullahi alayka ibn Adam. They say, oh man, oh human, may Allah curse you. May the curse of Allah be upon you. Munitna al-qatra min ajli ma'asiyatikum. He says, we don't get rain because of your disobedience. There's drought, there's famine, there's starvation because of your mutiny against Allah. So disobeying Allah Azza wa Jalla and His Messenger is the cause behind every problem that we face and suffer from today, is that we are not obeying Allah and His Messenger. So with that being said, brothers and sisters, do not spy upon your wife. Do not spy upon your husband. Do not spy on your children. Do not spy on your parents. Do not spy on your neighbors. If you have reason to think or to feel, if you need to make precautions and protect yourself and not be naive, that's a different story. That's a different story. But do not make unwarranted thoughts against your brother. And once you open up that door, know for sure you're opening up a very large and heavy door. And you may not be able to close it. And you may not be able to deal when the door comes off of the hinges. So be pleased with that which is apparent to you. And oftentimes, the happiest person is the one who knows the least. As they say, ignorance is bliss. Ignorance is bliss. Meaning, I don't need to know everything about you. You're a good friend to me, alhamdulillah. What you do in your own personal time is none of my concern. It's none of my concern. As long as you're good and thorough when it comes to me and you. And then life becomes better. So we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to open our eyes and open our hearts and open our ears. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to allow us to live as a community and as a society, as households, as families. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to make and improve and help all of our marriages and our relationships with our children and our stepchildren and everyone that we come across, teacher, student, man, woman, child, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala surely knows best.